Okay, welcome everybody. We might get started. We've still got some people that are arriving and we are letting them in from the lobby, but we might get started this morning. We've got a bit of an introduction. First of all, happy National Science Week, everybody. We're so pleased to be talking to you this week and we hope that you are all safe no matter where you are joining us from today. My name is Kate Green and I am part of the communications team at the Australian Institute of Marine Science, and we're so excited to be sharing some of our science from below the sea with you this week. Firstly, we acknowledge the traditional owners of the AIM sites and pay our respect to them as the first scientists in this land, and acknowledge the important contribution this unique wisdom provides to contemporary scientific conversations and collaborations. We acknowledge the deep and timeless connection between Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people, their land and sea country, and pay respects to elders past, present, and acknowledge the future leaders of tomorrow. Now, before we get started, well, some of you might be wondering, who are AIMS? Well, we are the Australian Institute of Marine Science, the nation's tropical marine research agency. Our science focuses on the tropical waters of Northern Australia, from Ningaloo in the west, across the Top End and to the Southern Great Barrier Reef. AIMS scientists are based in Townsville, where I'm sitting with you today, Darwin and Perth, where our presenter Michele Thums will be speaking with you today. And we're very pleased to be preparing our celebrations for our 50-year anniversary in 2022. Our marine research helps improve ocean health and protects coral reefs from climate change to help create economic, social, and environmental benefits for all Australians. Now, on to today's topic. They are one of the biggest animals that has ever lived on the planet, but pygmy blue whales are hard to find and even more difficult to study. Dr. Michele Thums has been working with other research organisations on Australia's west coast to learn more about pygmy blue whale's secret life, ensuring we have the information that we need to protect them. Dr. Thums is a marine megafauna ecologist and senior research scientist here at AIMS. Her research uses animal-borne telemetry, survey data, and a range of methods to understand the movement, distribution, and important habitats of threatened and migratory species such as whales, turtles, and sharks. She's published over 60 manuscripts in peer-reviewed scientific journals on these topics and leads numerous research projects, which are used to inform decision makers in both government and industry. Dr. Thums has a PhD in marine ecology from the University of Tasmania and a Bachelor of Science with first class honours in zoology from the University of Sydney. Now, at the conclusion of Michele's pygmy blue whale research talk, if you've got any questions, you will have the opportunity to ask them. We're going to be using the chat function today. So you can, to use this chat at the end of the talk, you can click the speech bubble at the top of your screen to enable the chat window. Now, today we won't be using the raise hand function, just that chat function. We'll get to as many questions as we can at the end of this talk for about 10 minutes or so. Okay, now enough of me rambling on. We are here to hear about pygmy blue whales from Dr. Thums. So over to you, Michele.
Thanks very much, Kate, and thanks everyone for tuning in this morning. Can everyone see my screen? Okay. Hopefully you can. So
yes, we can, Michele. All looking good.
Thanks very much, Kate. Okay, well, thanks everyone for joining. And today I'm really happy to be talking to you during National Science Week about uncovering the secret life of the pygmy blue whale. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about this enigmatic species and also about the research that we've been doing on them off Western Australia. And particularly our research focus has been on uncovering their important feeding areas. Hang on, I think my slide is advancing, is it, Kate?
No, it wasn't. So we can try that again if you like, no worries. This is a relatively new platform that we're using today, everybody. So thanks for your patience. It's a little bit of a learning curve for everyone.
Perhaps I'll just stop sharing again for a minute.
Looks like you have stopped sharing, Michele. Now we're sharing again, and that's in your not in presenter mode yet. So I'll try that one. There we go. Looking good.
Okay, sorry about that. First to some acknowledgements. This work was conducted as part of the Northwest Shoals to Shore Research Program, which was sponsored by Santos as part of that company's commitment to better understand WA's marine environment. And AIMS acknowledges the traditional owners of country along the Australian coastline where this work was undertaken. And we recognise these people's ongoing spiritual and physical connection to country and pay our respects to their Aboriginal elders, past, present and emerging. I want to acknowledge our main research collaborators on the project, which is the Centre for Whale Research and the Centre for Marine Science and Technology at Curtin University. And we also acknowledge our industry and research partners that made a lot of data sets available to the project and all the individuals listed here who provided assistance to make the research happen. So a bit of background to this enigmatic species. As some of you probably know, blue whales are the largest animal in the world. And the pygmy blue whale is a subspecies, and it's really poorly named as it's about 24.5 metres in length, which is only a few metres shorter than the largest one in the group, which is the Antarctic blue whale, that gets up to 30 metres long and 120 tonnes in weight. And for reference, here is a picture of a blue whale to scale next to a scuba diver. So you can see they're really massive. And as a bit of extra reference, the average bus is about 14 metres long, so they're very much bigger than that as well. So pygmy blue whales are found in the southern Indian and the South Pacific Ocean, and they occur at low density, far from shore at the continental shelf edge, and they spend much of their lives underwater where we can't see them. And it's these aspects that make them really difficult to study, and of course why so many aspects of their life are indeed secret. So the population which I'm studying is the one which visits the western and southern Australian coastlines, which is known as the Eastern Indian Ocean or the Indo-Australian Pygmy Blue. And the Jenners, my collaborators on this project, who've been studying these animals for many decades, have found that they migrate along the WA coastline from summer feeding grounds at the subtropical convergence and the Bonny upwelling and also the Perth Canyon, and they migrate up to Indonesia in the winter where it's thought that they breed. Now, for those of you that don't know, the Bonny upwelling is in the Great Australian Bight. And an upwelling is an area where cold, nutrient-dense water is upwelled to the surface. And this upwelling creates prey aggregations which the pygmy blue whales feed on. And such upwellings also occur in the Perth Canyon, which is, of course, off Perth in very deep water. And these canyons, the deep sides of the canyons, also concentrate the prey, and so the pygmy blue whales also feed there. Blue whales are listed as endangered species, and this designation is partly related to the fact that their populations are still recovering from commercial whaling last century, and where they were brought to the edge of extinction. However, that does not occur these days, thankfully. But the impact of whaling on pygmy blue whales was not well known, as they were actually not described until the 1960s. And prior to that, it was thought that pygmy blue whales and Antarctic blue whales were the same species. We don't really know how many there are. There have been some surveys off Western Australia in the past, and these have estimated up to about as many as 2,000 animals. But these counts weren't of the whole population, and they were a few decades ago now. So under Australian regulations, the instrument that addresses the recovery of pygmy blue whales is the Conservation Management Plan, and its objective is to minimise anthropogenic threats to allow for their recovery. Now, the plan identifies a number of threats, and these include whaling, climate change, noise interference, and vessel disturbance. And although commercial whaling is no longer allowed under the International Whaling Commission, it can recommence, especially as these whales start to recover. So it's still listed as a threat. In terms of climate change, it's the same for many migratory species. They may change their movement behaviour, and their prey availability may also change because their movement behaviour changes. And like many other baleen whales, pygmy blue whales use sound for communication. So anthropogenic noise in their environment can disrupt behaviours like feeding, and loud sounds can cause injury to their hearing. Death and injury from ship strike is thought to be limiting the recovery of blue whales on the west coast of the USA. And while we haven't recorded any ship strikes of blue whales on our coastline, it's very difficult to see these events and record them. And what's important to note, though, is that we have very busy shipping routes along our coastline, and these overlap with the areas that pygmy blue whales use. So the Conservation Management Plan provides a map that shows, to the best of our knowledge, when it was written, that is, the pygmy blue whale distribution and biologically important areas. And I'll refer to these biologically important areas during my talk as BIAs, so just keep that in mind. And so the biologically important areas are where aggregations of individuals, in this case pygmy blue whales, display biologically important behaviour, such as calving, foraging, resting, or migration. And so if you look at this map here, you'll notice that there is a level of uncertainty associated with some of the categories within the map, such as likely to occur, possible foraging area, that's the orange polygons on the map, may occur, because at the time that the map was made, there was only limited information to draw on, and so expert knowledge was used rather than quantitative analysis to identify these areas. And so why is that a problem? This uncertainty has implications for impact and risk evaluation of threats to pygmy blue whales. Now, our study is focused in Western Australia and particularly in the northwest. And in this area, there's a lot of oil and gas production and development going on. And so this is an area where pygmy blue whales also occur. And so noise from this industry, such as from drilling and pile driving and seismic air guns, and also vessel movement, and not just from this industry, from shipping and other vessels, creates noise and also has the risk of a strike. So failure to define the important areas effectively, and importantly, these are so-called possible foraging areas, may impede the rate of population recovery if anthropogenic activities such as these result in injury or displacement from significant foraging areas. So the aim of our project was to refine the distribution and improve the certainty around the spatial extent of the biologically important areas. Our main approaches were satellite telemetry and passive acoustic monitoring, which I'll refer to as PAM. And so this is simply recording the sounds of pygmy blue whales. Because they're very difficult to see, they are not so difficult to hear if you put recording instruments in the water. So we set out to collaborate with industry and researchers to access existing PAM and satellite telemetry data, and we also undertook new deployments of satellite transmitters and sound recorders to fill data gaps in the northwest. So a bit of an introduction to satellite tracking, or satellite tagging as it's commonly called. It's a very useful technique to provide data on the behaviour, distribution and movement of marine megafauna, and it's a method that I commonly use in my work. So firstly, and this is the critical bit, the device is attached to the animal, and I'll talk about this difficult task in the next slide. And every time the animal surfaces to breathe, a device attempts to make connection with the overhead satellites and transmits the signal. And then the satellite relays the data to a receiving station. And at the receiving station, the data are processed so the location estimates can be calculated. And then the data are sent to the researcher, which is me. And so this happens in semi-real time. And then once I get the data, then I can plot up all the tracks of the whales and or whatever animal I'm tracking and see where they went and where they spent time. So how do we find the whales? Well, we look for them and we listen for them. So in collaboration with the Center for Whale Research on board the research vessel, the Whale Song, which is sound here, we look for the whales and we use visual surveys from the ship. And we also look for them using a light aircraft because we get a lot more visibility from up in the air. But from the ship, we can sometimes see the animals, but mostly we look for the blows. So when the whales come to the surface to breathe, they forcefully expel air through their blowhole, as shown in the picture on the right. And the spray is what's known as the blow, and it's visible from the ship up to 5 miles away. So we also listen for the whales, and we can hear them up to 100 kilometres away using sound detection equipment known as sonobuoys. And this technology is very cool, and it's what the Navy uses to hunt submarines, and it was a crucial piece of equipment in our toolkit. So we drop the sonobuoys into the ocean, as you can see Kurt doing that here, and they have built-in hydrophones, which are underwater microphones. And these detect the sounds, sort of the whale calls, as they're made, and they transmit them by radio signals back to the ship. And then using complex computer software that you can see here in the picture, the approximate position of each calling whale can then be calculated. So once the whales were located by either of these means, we were then deployed into a small boat to try and get close enough to deploy the tag. But even once the pygmy blue whales are found, it's still really difficult to get close enough to them to attach the small tracking devices. Because they're usually underwater, they only spend short periods of time at the surface. And while they are underwater, of course, it's really difficult for us to track them and follow them because we can't see them. And the pilot also can't see them at that point because they're often just too deep and they can only be seen as they're coming to the surface and when they're within about 5 metres of the surface. We have to be very patient. We do a lot of following at a safe distance because we also want to get the whales used to the sight of us and also the sound of us. The whales don't like the sound of the boat. Thankfully, this is one that's not too noisy. But so eventually, after many hours, and sometimes this doesn't actually happen at all, we can get close enough to the whale to deploy the tag. But it's very difficult, and especially in difficult sea conditions, which is often what we have where it's quite windy and choppy. Of course, I'm showing you pictures that were taken on very beautiful days. And here in this photo, there's a red arrow, hopefully you can see, and it's pointing to the small satellite tag, which is also shown in the picture here on the whale's body. And you probably can't see it, and that's the point, because these tags are very small. So I've got a video to show you here of the deployment of the satellite transmitter from the inflatable boat here. And this is really a textbook example with flat, calm conditions, but it's not usually like this, and the video also makes it look really easy, but we were following this whale for hours to try and get into a position to be alongside it in close enough range to deploy the satellite tag. So the video is just going in a loop. So the tag is attached using a modified tranquilizer gun that you can just see in the picture there. So it uses compressed air, it fires an arrow, and at the end of the arrow is the tag,
which so you'll see here as it's fired, the arrow bounces off the whale and the tag remains on the whale's body. And the tags stay attached until they fall off or the batteries stop transmitting. And so we combined the data that we got from the tags deployed on whales. We did this at Ningaloo. And we combined the data with previous satellite tag deployments that had been done. And here I'm going to show you an animation of all the tracked whales combined. And so let's play that now. And so the ones from Ningaloo were shown in the green colours. The ones from Perth Canyon are shown in the red colours. And we had one tagged in the Bonny Upwelling that's shown in blue. So you can see they migrate along our coast up to Indonesia. They mooch around there for a while, and it's thought that that's where they do the breeding and calving. And you can see only for a couple of whales, we got a southern migration. So mostly all the satellite tracking data is for the northern migration. So these animals cover really huge distances, as you can see. So here's a static map of the tracks from the whales we tagged off Ningaloo. And here the tracks are colour-coded by the movement behaviour that underlies the tracks. So fast and straight movement is shown in blue, and this is indicative of migration, whereas slow movement, where there's lots of turning, is indicative of feeding or breeding. And this is because when whales come across a swarm of krill, for example, they slow down to try and catch the krill and have a feed. And similarly, after their migration, when they arrive at the breeding grounds, they slow down and they spend time being resident for their breeding activities. Excuse me. So in this picture that I'm showing here on the right, this is a really rare picture. It's a picture of a feeding blue whale at the surface. Now, the whale's upside down with its throat pleats expanded with a mouthful of water, which is mixed with food, which is its krill. So it's not only rare to photograph this, it's rare to even see this because, as I said before, they spend a lot of their lives underwater and some of the feeding occurs at depth, not always at the surface. And because it's difficult to observe feeding behaviour, that's why we need these proxies of where they feed, such as what we can gain from looking at the underlying movement behaviour that I just talked about. So the slow movement with the high turning angles, which is where we think that they're feeding. And here are the tracks from the previous deployments that we compiled for the project. So those deployed in the Perth Canyon on the left and off the Bonny Coast in South Australia on the right. And again, colour-coded by the movement behaviour, with the warmer colours foraging or breeding and the cooler colours showing migration behaviour. So how did we identify important foraging areas? Well, we combined all the tracking data and we used the movement behaviour that I just described. And we also use two other methods for them. So for the movement behaviour, we took the parts of the track where the whales exhibited movement behaviour that is indicative of foraging. And so that's the slow movement with lots of turning. So all the warmer colours on the parts of the track on the left. The left plot also shows some habitat layers, but just ignore that. And then for the other two methods, we overlaid a 20 by 20 kilometre grid cell over the study area and we summed the time that the whales spent, which is shown in the middle plot. And in the right plot, we calculate the proportion of tagged whales using each grid cell. So the very pale bluey purple colours in the middle plot is where the whales spend less time, and the darker areas where the colour palette moves from blue to green to orange is where they spend more time. And similarly with the plot on the right, the purpley blue areas are where only few whales occurred, and the darker areas of red, yellow and green blue are where more whales use. And we had a similar process for looking at where the most important migration areas are.
This time taking the parts of the track where the whales exhibited movement behaviour indicative of migration, which is shown in blue in the map on the left, and only taking the grid cells that had the most whales using them, which is shown in right in the red, yellow and blue-green colours. And so how to identify the most important foraging areas? So that is shown on the left, and the most important migration areas on the right. And we did this by overlaying all these metrics, and we designated the most important areas as those areas where all the metrics overlap, and that's shown in red. So just to summarise, the most important areas for foraging is where they had the occurrence of the foraging movement behaviour, where the whales spent the most time, and the areas that the most whales used. And for the important migration areas, it's similar, except that we don't use the third metric, which is where whales spent the most time. And that's because when whales are migrating, they're travelling very quickly, so they don't spend much time. So I'll just zoom in a bit now so you can see a bit more detail. So this is zoomed to the northwest, which is our main study area of interest. And if we focus on the left map, the red areas are the most important foraging areas, and the green polygons are these biologically important areas, or BIAs, that I talked about at the start of the talk, which are delineated in the conservation management plan for pygmy blue whales. And what you can see is that the BIAs, the possible foraging BIA, have only very low amount of overlap with the area that we calculated as most important for foraging for these tagged whales. And in fact, only 6% overlap. And so similarly on the right, the red areas are the most important migration areas, and overlaid in pink is the migration BIA that's identified by the government. And in this instance, the most important migration areas we calculated from these tagged whales is encompassed by the migration BIA, which is good news. And but what you will see is that if we look at all the cells where migration behaviour occurred, and that's shown in brown, and not just the most important areas shown in red, then you can see that the migratory pathway is actually much wider than the migration BIA suggests. And you'll also note that the tracked whales did not use the shallow continental shelf area. And that is the area from about the 200-kilometre contour that I'm pointing to here, right up to the coastline. But the distribution BIA encompasses this whole area. So switching gears now to talk about the passive acoustic monitoring. And so PAM, as I referred to it before, is just the recording of sounds of whales and using the detections of their sounds as a proxy for the whale presence. And we do this because these whales, like many baleen whales, they're so difficult to observe in their wild, but the sounds can be easily recorded. So we recorded the sound, we deployed the sound recorders at Northwest Cape at Ningaloo, and they were deployed on the seafloor. And then we also had sound recorders that we attached onto IMOS ocean gliders. And so these ocean gliders, they're really cool instruments. They're used by oceanographers to study oceanographic phenomena. So they get deployed into the ocean and they're operated remotely. They're essentially robots. They dive up and down in the water column, and as they dive, they record all sorts of oceanographic parameters like water temperature and salinity and a host of other things. But in this case, we attach these sound recorders to them. And so you can see that in the pictures, the one in the top is just the glider with the sound recorders attached at first getting ballasted in a bath in the lab before it gets deployed. So the paths that the glider took are shown in blue on this map. So we had three deployments of them.
And so what we tried to do was fill the gaps in between where we had other data, which we also included in this project. So the black squares on the map are from existing data from fixed acoustic loggers that were deployed for other projects. And the red crosses are these instruments known as ocean bottom seismometers. And these instruments weren't deployed by us, they were also deployed by others previously, and they were deployed to record seismic activity in the ocean floor. But it turns out these instruments also record pygmy blue whales, so that was really useful for us, so we could also use the sounds that they recorded for our study. So what we did to further understand the areas that pygmy blue whales use was that we mapped the relationship between the number of singing whales, and that's a proxy for their presence, and a range of environmental variables like sea surface temperature and also month. And so the good thing about using the counts of the whale singers is that the data actually covered both the northern and the southern migration, unlike the satellite tracking data, which I showed you before, which mostly gave us information about the northern migration. And so you can see in the map here that it shows a similar story to what I showed you with the satellite tracking data, and that is that there's a higher density of singing whales in the southern extent of the northwest of Western Australia, which is shown in yellow-green colours. And so this sort of matches the area you know, where the satellite tracking data showed that the whales spent more time, and the blue areas is where they were more likely migrating, as we learned from the satellite tracking data. And so the peak of the singers that were recorded throughout the years of the data was in May on the northern migration shown on the left, and in November on the southern migration, which is shown in this map on the right. And so what are the outcomes of our research? Well, the secret life of pygmy blue whales has been exposed. Well, not completely, because there's still so much we don't know. For example, the breeding and calving area is still not confirmed, but we have uncovered the key areas that they use for feeding and migration. And this is really important for impact and risk evaluation of threats from anthropogenic activities for pygmy blue whales. And we've provided data to assist the government in refining the biologically important areas that they list in their conservation management plan. So I'd like to thank all our project partners that are shown here, and I think I mentioned them all at the start of the talk as well. And I want to thank you all for listening and your interest in this research on pygmy blue whales. And I'll hand back now to Kate to lead the question time if there are any.
Excellent. Thank you so much, Michele. That's been absolutely fascinating. The way technology can help us hone in on this secret life is just brilliant. Unfortunately, our technology wasn't working as well today for the webinar. So, we've got a bit of back feed on here. Apologies, everybody. What we're going to do, instead of having the chat function, which I think some of you might have already tried to put a question in, we're going to get you to raise your hand using the smiley face with the hand up icon just next to the chat function at the top. And when I call your name, I'm going to get the lovely Marie, one of our team members, to unmute you, and the audience will be able to ask the question themselves. So we're just having to bypass that written chat function at this point. I do have one question to kick us off, Michele. What drove you to follow this line of ecology? I mean, it's such a romantic thing to look at, you know, let's find the whales and the turtles using this technology. Was there a particular point at which you decided to follow this line of science?
Well, it just came about through my choice of PhD topic. So I studied the foraging ecology of southern elephant seals, actually, in the Southern Ocean at Macquarie Island. And just like pygmy blue whales, southern elephant seals spend most of their lives at sea, underwater. And so really it's just the only way to understand what these animals do. And you know, I've got a love of marine life and nature. And so in order to study them, I learnt about satellite tagging and telemetry, and I just thought it sounded like a really great way to understand these animals, and it really has been. It just offers such a great window into their world. And there are also a lot of different instruments now, some that have cameras as well, that you can actually see what they see, and it really is fascinating.
Yeah, it's just getting better and better, isn't it? So, I mean, you started your PhD with elephant seals. I'm guessing that's because you didn't have to get in the cold water.
Yes, that's right. Yeah. Well, the good thing about southern elephant seals, unlike pygmy blue whales, is they come ashore. They come ashore for breeding, so they have their babies on land, and that's where they nurse them and so on, and then they go back to sea to feed. But, of course, whales don't come ashore, so they're very much more difficult to find and attach tags to.
Terrific. All right. We've got a question from Katarina Fabricius in the audience there. We'll just unmute her microphone. You there, Katarina?
So I haven't unmuted her, but I think she needs to unmute herself as well.
Ah, Katarina, are you able to unmute your microphone? There we go.
Okay, perfect. Hi. Thanks, Michele. Great talk. I've got two questions. One is, do we have any idea what they're feeding on while they're traveling up the coast? Food density would be so much lower than in the Antarctic. And the second one is, what has been identified as a pygmy blue whale had beached itself at the Ames jetty in Townsville about 10 years ago. That part of the coast is not part of your distribution map. So would that have been a misidentification or a stray whale or a new record? The skeleton of that whale is now in the Queensland Museum.
Yeah, that's interesting. Thanks, Katarina. First to your question about what they feed on. So they feed on krill and other small zooplankton. And so whilst they do target those upwelling areas that I mentioned, like the Perth Canyon and the Bonny Upwelling, it's also thought that they feed on root as well. These animals, they're very lean. They don't carry a lot of body fat like some other species that people might know of, like humpback whales. So they need to feed really regularly. So they'll do so opportunistically as they're migrating. Outside of these areas, there might be long periods of time where there isn't any opportunity. So I think that is why we do see some stretches of the coast where they just seem to be migrating and not feeding. And in terms of your other question, it's not part of their range, we do always see species of animals that are outside of their range. So for whatever reason, they might be young animals and inexperienced, or they might get stuck in storms or other types of oceanographic events that mean they do sometimes end up in areas where they're not normally found. And in those cases, they might struggle to find food, and so they might get sick and wind up as you've indicated that one has washed ashore. So I'd be really interested to hear more about it.
Terrific. Thank you, Katarina and Michele. I can't see any other raised hands in the audience. We do have a comment. Somebody's been able to use the chat. That's excellent news. Harry is asking if the slides could be shared to the attendees. I think that'll have to go through Michele. So if you would like to email her at m.thums@ames.gov.au to get more information on the slides. But just at this point, we noticed that there were some people that were having trouble staying in the webinar, we will be putting the recording of the webinar on YouTube, and we'll share that link on our social media when it's up. So if anyone has had a bit of trouble or you've arrived late, you are very welcome to watch that recording over the next couple of days on our social media channels. So I'm just going to leave it for one last time. If there are any questions throughout the audience, just having a look at the participation here. Can't see anybody. No, that looks to be it. Okay. Well, thank you very much. Such a wonderful thing to think about on this day when there is so much happening in the world. We really appreciate everybody's time and coming in, sharing a celebration of science and how we are really unraveling the mysteries of these amazing creatures. Thank you so much for coming. We do have another talk on Thursday with Dr. Katerina Fabricius on ocean acidification. I'd like to thank Dr. Michele Thums for spending the time with us this morning to teach us more about these amazing creatures. All right then, everybody. Thank you so much for attending today. All the best, and stay safe, and we'll talk to you soon. Bye.